Hello and welcome to a new episode of Legal Wrangle. In today's episode on corporate laws, we will analyze three important current decisions which would have a long-lasting impact on the Indian corporate sector. Let us begin with the first decision of the Supreme Court on the telecom sector. In this case, the Apex Court dealt with the question that whether on matters pertaining to telecom pending before the TRAI, the CCI can order an investigation under the Competition Act. To understand the crux of the matter, let us dwell deep in the facts of the case.
In 2013, Reliance Jio Infocom Limited was granted license for the launch of Jio Telecommunications. The launch date was scheduled for September 2016. In early 2016, the Jio sought from the dominant operators, namely Bharti Airtel Limited, Vodafone India Limited and Idea Cellular Limited, to provide point of access for seamless operation of the network. Ruffled over the delay in providing the point of access, Jio approached the TRAI to intervene in the matter. On TRAI's directions, the respondents agreed to do the needful. On further delay, the TRAI was approached again. At this point of time, the Cellular Operators Association of India gave a statement that Reliance was choking the point of access by granting free services to millions of existing and new users under the guise of test. The ball once again came back to the TRAI, which issued show cause notices. In November 2016, after the public launch of Jio services, Reliance approached the CCI alleging formation of cartel and anti-competitive agreement by the respondents. In furtherance of such allegation, the CCI ordered an investigation by the Director General. The respondents challenged the CCI jurisdiction to pass an order for investigation before the High Court successfully. The CCI hence appealed to the Supreme Court.
The Supreme Court dismissed the CCI appeal and held that the writ petition challenging the order of the CCI on the question of jurisdiction was maintainable before the High Court. However, the court also stated that the High Court's approach was also wrong in labeling the CCI order as quasi-judicial when it was merely an administrative order issued after the invocation of Section 26 of the Competition Act.
The telecom market is regulated by the statutory body under the TRAI Act. As an expert regulatory body which specifically governs the telecom sector, the disputes pertaining to telecom are to be decided by the TRAI in the first instance. The TRAI, being a specialized sectoral regulator, is armed with sufficient power to ensure fair, non-discriminatory and competitive market in the telecom sector and is better suited to decide these cases. Once the TRAI takes over and its findings are returned, which leads to the prima facie conclusion that the dominant operators have indulged in anti-competitive practices, the CCI can be activated to investigate the matter going by the criteria laid down in the relevant provisions of the Competition Act. Thus, till the jurisdictional issues are straightened up by the TRAI bringing on record its findings, the CCI is handicapped to proceed in the matter.
In a nutshell, even though CCI has powers to scrutinize anti-competitive agreements transcend to every industry including telecom industry, TRAI being a specialized authority is better equipped than the CCI in matters concerning telecom in the first instance. If two investigations are allowed to carry on side by side by two different authorities, there may be a possibility that they may arrive at conflicting views. In this case, the issue was whether a resolution once approved by the majority in the Committee of Creditors could be reversed in favor of another resolution with more potential for profit. Let us begin our analysis by understanding the facts of the matter.
The Bank of Baroda filed an insolvency application against its lender, that is the Binani Cement Limited. The National Company Law Tribunal initiated the corporate insolvency resolution process. The court appointed a resolution professional who invited submissions for resolutions. In the process, Messrs. Rajputana Properties Private Limited and Ultratech Cements Limited filed their proposals. The proposal of Rajputana Properties was passed by the majority of the Committee of Creditors. The resolution professional thereafter filed an application for the approval of the resolution plan for Binani Cement Limited. At this point, another resolution plan was submitted by Ultratech Cement Limited and Binani Industries Ltd. The adjudicating authority was dissatisfied by the resolution plan and remitted the matter back to the Committee of Creditors for reconsideration. Challenging the orders of the adjudicating authority, the matter went to the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal and then to the Apex Court, which directed to transfer the insolvency petition from the adjudicating authority to the Company Law Appellate Tribunal for passing an appropriate order in the matter. Thereafter, the Committee of Creditors convened another meeting to consider the revised plan submitted by Ultratech Cement Limited. Multiple appeals from the first order of the adjudicating authority were filed before the Company Law Appellate Tribunal, challenging the remittance of resolution for reconsideration and allowing the Committee of Creditors to reconsider the settlement plan proposed by Ultratech Cement Limited.
The tribunal allowed the appeal preferred by the RP while dismissing all other appeals. The tribunal was of the view that the order of the adjudicating authority to reconsider a resolution plan already approved by the Committee of Creditors was appropriate in law and was passed to safeguard the interest of the stakeholders.
The Appellate Tribunal observed that Rajputana Properties Private Limited in its resolution plan has discriminated against some of the financial creditors and put operational creditors at a disadvantage. Thus, lesser percentage of claims was given to a certain set of similar creditors. The tribunal observed that the resolution professional as well as the committee of creditors were duty bound to ensure maximization of value within the time frame prescribed by the IBC. Such an object in finding out a resolution application which can offer maximum amount so as to safeguard the interest of all stakeholders of the corporate debtor is lacking in the cases in hand from the side of the Committee of Creditors. In the present case, the Committee of Creditors not only failed to safeguard the interest of the shareholders of the corporate debtor while approving the resolution plan submitted by Rajputana Properties Private Limited, but also ignored the revised resolution plan offered by Ultratech Cement Limited, which has taken care of maximization of the assets of the corporate debtor and also balanced the claim of all the stakeholders of the corporate debtor. The tribunal also stated that an insolvency application once filed cannot be withdrawn at a later date merely because the promoter of the financially stressed company has offered to pay all the outstanding dues.
In a nutshell, the tribunal affirmed that the insolvency process must seek to extract maximum value from resolution of stressed assets and ensure that interests of operational creditors who do not form part of the committee of creditors are also well served. Let us now move on to our last case, which refers to the order of the High Court entertaining the issue of whether a leave under Section 446 of the Companies Act is compulsory for commencing resolution process after the appointment of official liquidator for liquidation of the company.
The corporate debtor is engaged in diverse businesses involving production of agro-based products and cement. Multiple petitions for winding up were filed against the debtor by the creditors due to non-payment of debts. The High Court appointed a provisional liquidator to take charge of all the assets of the debtor. One of the creditors, Edelweiss Asset Reconstruction Company, filed an application to initiate corporate insolvency process against the debtor. The NCLT accepted the application, initiating the corporate insolvency resolution process and appointed the IRP. The IRP invited submissions for resolution. Later, the IRP was made aware of the appointment of the provisional liquidator by the High Court. After the meeting with the Committee of Creditors, the IRP filed an application for leave of the High Court to continue with the insolvency resolution process. Alternatively, the IRP also applied for stay of the liquidation order pending the completion of the corporate insolvency resolution process of the debtor.
The application for leave to continue with the resolution process was allowed with conditions. The condition was that in case of failure of the IRP, the court seized of the matter would be justified in initiating the liquidation process of the company.
The rationale in taking leave from the court seized of the winding up petition was found fair on the grounds that the court must be made aware of any resolution process after it undertakes the liquidation process. This is to avoid conflicting claims being made and allowed in respect of the company. Resolution of insolvency of a company and liquidation of a company are two processes which pull at each other. The former is about the rejuvenation of life and the latter is about the termination of life. It was observed that the creditors initiated the winding up proceedings of the corporate debtor and not for a compromise and making arrangements for reconstruction of the company under Section 391. Even though revival of a sick company is possible under Section 391 of the Act of 1956, it is dependent upon the volition of the parties and not upon the unilateral action of any creditor. However, under the IBC, the revival of a company is possible even at the behest of a financial creditor or an operational creditor or a corporate applicant as contemplated under the IBC. Thus, looking at the objective for the enactment of the IBC, which was rooted principally in achieving efficacy and speed in making efforts to revive a dying company and securing protection of the interests of its creditors and other stakeholders, the application for revival must be given precedence over the pending liquidation process.
In a nutshell, in the question of proceeding with a resolution plan for the revival of the company and safeguarding the interest of stakeholders or the liquidation process, precedence must be given to the implementation of resolution process. If such implementation fails, the liquidation proceeding can commence to adjust the interest of creditors. With this, we wrap up this episode of Legal Wrangle. Keep watching TIOL Tube for more such episodes. If you have any suggestions, please write in at editor@tiol.in. Thank you for watching TIOL Tube.